Hello everyone, welcome to my video lecture on hydraulic pumps. In my previous class, I have given you the details about the introduction part of the hydraulic pumps, and also we have understood the classification and also the specification of the hydraulic pump. In today's class, we will be discussing about the centrifugal pump, its advantages, how is it useful in daily applications, and also we will see what are the two important aspects which we need to understand in centrifugal pumps. So here I am Shamanth, who will be explaining you about the centrifugal pump. I work as an assistant professor in Global Academy of Technology in the Department of Mechanical Engineering. So this is our main discussion topic. It is centrifugal pump. So let us see what exactly the centrifugal pump is. So yesterday when I discussed about the classification of hydraulic pumps, there are three types of hydraulic pumps what is there for your discussion. Under that we classified as centrifugal pump, and then reciprocating pump, and also the rotary pump. Whereas the rotary pump is not for our subject of discussion. We will only be discussing about centrifugal pump as well as reciprocating pump. Under that, the first type of pump that we are discussing today is centrifugal pump. This is what the centrifugal pump you will be learning today. And when I was telling you about the classification of centrifugal pump, I told you it is the most widely used pump across your domestic applications. So we'll see what exactly the centrifugal pump is. So a centrifugal pump, it is a mechanical device which is designed to move a fluid. So any pump for that matter, it is designed to move a fluid. It does not mean only water. It can also move any type of fluid, say for example the lubrication. Lubrication are of many types, that is oil or any other lubricant whatever you use in a machine. So you require a pump to move that particular fluid from one place to another place. So it is a mechanical device which is designed to move a fluid by means of the transfer of rotational energy from one or more driven rotors, which is called as the impellers. So here the centrifugal pump, it transfers the rotational energy from one or more driven rotors, which is called as the impeller. And mainly the name of the pump, it says centrifugal. It is nothing but it makes use of the centrifugal force to impart the energy to the liquid. Okay, so centrifugal force, you all know what exactly is a centrifugal force. What is centrifugal force? It is a force arising from the body's inertia, that is, which appears to act on a body moving in a circular path and is directed, and always it is directed. If you have a circle, then so it will be directed outward. The centrifugal force will be directed outwards, that is, in a circular path, and is directed away from the center around which the body is moving. If the body is moving, then the centrifugal force is always directed outward. So that is why it is here the centrifugal force is used to impart the energy to the liquid. The action of impeller, it increases the fluid's velocity. When the impeller is acted upon, the fluid which is flowing in the casing of the pump, it increases the velocity of the fluid and pressure, and also it directs towards the pump outlet. So water enters from the inlet and then it exits through the outlet of the pump. So this is what the definition of a centrifugal pump. It is a mechanical device designed to move a fluid by means of the transfer of rotational energy from one or more driven rotors, which is called as impellers. It makes use of centrifugal force to impart the energy to the liquid, and centrifugal force is directed outwards. So you can understand that when the centrifugal force is acted upon the water which is flowing, the force will be directed outwards, so it makes the water to flow outwards radially. And the action of the impeller increases the fluid's velocity and pressure, and also directs it towards the pump outlet. So once you have understood about the definition of the centrifugal pump, you have got an idea what exactly the centrifugal pump is, Now we'll understand its construction. Construction of the centrifugal pump is very much important, and when you are writing or explaining about the centrifugal pump, you need to start with writing the construction of the centrifugal pump and then move on to write about its operation. So here there are four main parts of a centrifugal pump which are widely discussed. One is the impeller, then volute casing, suction pipe, and then delivery pipe. So these four parts we'll be discussing, and I will also be showing it to you here in the diagram. This is the diagram of the centrifugal pump. You can see here, this is the suction pipe, this area is the suction pipe, this is the delivery pipe, and then you can see the overhead tank here. This is the overhead tank, and then the suction pipe have the strainer here. So when the suction pipe is immersed in the reservoir where the water is stored, you might have the foreign particles which might enter into the suction pipe. So to avoid that, which might cause the damage to the blades of the turbine later on, we have a strainer here which strains the foreign particles so that the clean water enters into the suction pipe. You can also have the gauges in different places on the pipes. So just to check the vacuum gauge and also the pressure gauge is installed here, just to check the pressure and what exactly the vacuum is inside the pipe. So starting with the first part, is the impeller. Impeller is a wheel which is provided with a series of backward curved blades or vanes. So you have understood the importance of the blades while I explained you about the turbine in Pelton wheel turbine. It might be in reaction turbine, say Francis turbine or a Kaplan turbine. There were series of blades which were actually set up on the runner, and then the water strike the blades of the turbine, and then there was a force setup, and that is why the blades started to move in the higher velocity. So even similar type, even here there are blades which are backward curved. Very much important, it is backward curved blades. You can see here at the center, this is the backward curved blades which are set up at the center. We also call it as vanes. And the center of the impeller is called as eye of the impeller. The center portion of the impeller, this portion is called as the eye of the impeller, and the eye of the impeller is connected to the shaft of the electric motor. Okay, it is connected to the shaft of the electric motor. One thing you need to understand here is always the impeller is not situated exactly to the center of the casing or the pump. It is slightly shifted towards that. I'll tell you why is that. Okay, the next part is volute casing. Volute casing is an airtight chamber surrounding the impeller. If you have an impeller here, then whatever the area which is surrounding the impeller, so this portion is called as volute casing. And how is it? It is an airtight chamber. Volute casing is an airtight chamber which surrounds the impeller, and you can also notice that this volute casing has the increasing area. So here at the beginning you have small area, whereas while increasing the area, sorry, while moving on forward, the area increases. So what happens when there is a volute casing? The velocity of the water gradually decreases. Okay, when the velocity of the fluid decreases, what happens? It is understood that the pressure starts to increase. So that is why the volute casing has the increasing area. The next important part here is the suction pipe. So suction pipe, the lower end of the suction pipe is connected to the reservoir. As you can see here, the lower end of the suction pipe, is immersed in the sump or the reservoir, whereas the other end, is connected to the eye of the impeller. Okay, it is a circular pipe with its upper end connected to the center of the impeller, whereas the lower end immersed in the reservoir. So suction pipe is very much important, because as the impeller starts to rotate, the water which is present in the reservoir has to be sucked, and then it has to be pushed to the overhead tank through the delivery pipe. So it is very much important, suction pipe. Then we have a delivery pipe. Delivery pipe, the lower end is connected to the outlet of the pump. So here this is the lower end. Lower end of the pump is connected to the outlet of the pump, whereas the upper end is connected to the tank. This is the upper end, it is connected to the tank where the water has to be stirred. So this is the important parts of the centrifugal pump, and there are some gauges here. Pressure gauge is there, then vacuum gauge is here. There you can see the flanges. Flanges are used to connect two or more pipes, so that is the importance of flanges here. And then you can see delivery valve. So whenever you need to transfer the water from the reservoir to the overhead tank, this delivery valve should be open so that water is easily transferred to the overhead tank. If the valve is closed, what happens? The water cannot be transferred to the overhead tank. So you can make use of these external mounting so that the pump will be run smoothly. Now coming to the operation part of the centrifugal pump. Operation of the centrifugal pump, hope you have understood all the parts of the centrifugal pump. So the operation part will become very much easy because as you have understood the parts of the centrifugal pump. Now I told you the eye of the impeller is connected to the shaft of the electric motor, right? So when the electric motor is switched on, the impeller rotates, creating suction at the suction pipe. So when the eye of the impeller starts to rotate, because you switch on the electric motor, the shaft of the electric motor is connected to the eye of the impeller. So it starts to rotate, which in turn is connected to the blades of the centrifugal pump. So blades also starts to rotate. During this rotation, it creates a suction. It creates a suction in the suction pipe. When the suction is created in the suction pipe, due to that suction created, the water from the sump starts flowing into the casing through the eye of the impeller. So water enters the suction pipe and it enters the volute casing. It enters this volute casing through the eye of the impeller. It enters the volute casing. The centrifugal force, after the water enters into the volute casing, it starts to move through the increasing area of the volute casing. When it is moving, the centrifugal force, which is created by the rotation of the impeller, so impeller keeps on rotating at high speed according to the RPM of the electric motor. When it is rotating at high speed, the centrifugal force is created and it acts on water. Okay, so the water will be flowing through the volute casing. That centrifugal force will be acted upon water, which causes it to flow radially outward and towards the outlet of the casing. Due to that force, centrifugal force, which is acted upon the water by the impeller, it makes the water to flow radially outwards. And hence it enters into the delivery valve. As the water flows through the casing, its velocity reduces. I told you, when it is passing through the volute casing, because of the increasing area, whatever the casing has, it decreases. Okay, the velocity of it reduces due to the increasing cross-sectional area of the casing. This decrease in velocity increases the pressure of the water flowing through the casing. So when velocity decreases, the pressure increases, and hence the water flows through the delivery pipe into the overhead tank. So this is how the operation of the centrifugal pump is. This is how centrifugal pump works. So you might have seen using hydraulic pumps at your houses. So if you want to transfer the water from the sump to the overhead tank, the same principle is applied, wherein the impeller starts to rotate, and when the impeller starts to rotate, there is a suction created at the suction pipe, and then it enters into the volute casing. After it enters into the volute casing, the centrifugal force acts on the water which is flowing through the volute casing, and it makes the it directs the water into the delivery pipe, and centrifugal force acts on the water due to the rotation of the impeller, and hence it is also further directed to the delivery valve, and then it is made to enter the outlet of the delivery valve and hence filling the overhead tank. So this is how the operation of the centrifugal pump is. Hope you have understood better. If you have not understood, please reach to me so that I can explain you clearly. Now we need to see what are the advantages, disadvantages and application of the centrifugal pumps. Advantages. The major advantages of the centrifugal pump are: it is suitable for all types of liquids. all types of liquids can be used in the centrifugal pump, not only water, even oil. Based on the different viscosity of the oil, you can use different liquids or fluids. Majorly centrifugal pumps are also used in different machines for lubrication purposes. So that is one of the major advantage of the centrifugal pumps. And then it is very much simple and compact. It is very simple and compact. And another advantage is that it can be mounted horizontally or vertically. Very good advantage the centrifugal pump has. Either horizontally or vertically it can be mounted, and then it is very easy to maintain, not much of maintenance is required. And the major disadvantage what the centrifugal pump face is, it has very relatively poor suction power. What exactly this means, relatively poor suction power, is that when the pump is dry, the rotation of the impeller even at high speed is not sufficient to lift the liquid. So as I told you, when the shaft of the motor rotates, the eye of the impeller also starts to rotate. In the previous slide I explained to you about the operation. When the shaft of the motor rotates and the eye of the impeller rotates, if the pump is dry, what happens? The pressure is not that much sufficient to lift the water. At that time you have to prime the pump. So priming is required. I will tell you in the next two slides I will come to that topic, whereas priming is very much necessary. So without priming you cannot make the pump to work. So that is why it has very relatively very poor suction power. And then it develops cavitation, resulting in structural failure of the impeller blades. Another major disadvantage the centrifugal pumps face is cavitation. I will also explain about this topic in the next slide. Okay, cavitation. And then it is not suitable for air or gases. If at all you want to pass some air or gas into the suction pipe or delivery pipe, it is not suitable for that. So this is the major disadvantage what the centrifugal pumps face. Applications, widely used. As I told you, centrifugal pumps are widely used in industry, agricultural purposes, municipal, for water and wastewater plants, power generation plants, then petroleum and many other industries. You can see centrifugal pumps in major places. Yes, I was talking about one of the disadvantage of the centrifugal pump, that is cavitation. In the previous slide, when I talked about disadvantage, I told you the cavitation results in failure of the pump. So you need to understand what exactly is the cavitation. So cavitation in centrifugal pump refers to the phenomenon of formation of vapor bubbles and its subsequent collapse in the lower pressure region around the impeller. So if vapor bubbles are formed, and when the vapor bubbles strike the pump casing or the blades of the pump, then you can actually see the holes here. So these are something which are created by the cavitation. So how does it happen? So it means that formation of vapor bubbles, you need to understand here that there are formation of vapor bubbles due to the lesser pressure region. So due to the lower pressure region, the formation of vapor bubbles happen, and its subsequent collapse creates cavitation inside the pump. How can it be identified? Cavitation can be identified by a clear audible noise and vibrations caused by the violent collapse of vapor bubbles. So you can actually know when exactly the cavitation is taking place. When cavitation occurs, the velocity of a liquid increases to the point where the consequent pressure drop reaches. So when the pressure drop reaches, the pressure vaporization of the liquid takes place. So where the consequent pressure drop reaches, the pressure of vaporization of the liquid happens, and that is when the velocity of the liquid increases. Because of that, the cavitation happens. So what happens is there is development of vapor pockets or vapor bubbles, as here the formation of vapor bubbles I told you. When these are formed in the liquid and then they later collapse, And when this collapse happens, collapse of vapor bubbles, you all can see, you would have played in vapor bubbles, and then as soon as you just prick the bubble, what happens? It just bursts out. And that collapse of vapor bubbles, which is happening inside the pump, it creates shock waves. When it creates a shock waves, what happens is it strikes the impeller, or it can strike the casing of the pump, which actually creates damage to the blades or the casing of the pump. That is why the cavitation, the formation of vapor bubbles, is very much dangerous for the pump, which can decrease the life of the pump. This is very much important. This is one of the important phenomenon which takes place in the cavitation because of the formation of vapor bubbles. Another important phenomenon in the centrifugal pump is priming. I told you relatively low suction power, and that happens because when you do not have much of the water left in the reservoir, or when you can say the pump is dry. When the pump is dry, what happens? You require priming, and that priming is the process of filling liquid into the casing, suction pipe and delivery pipe up to the delivery valve before starting the pump, and it is done manually. You can see here, this is the delivery pipe, and then you have the casing here, and then the suction pipe. So this has to be filled with water manually. So you can see water is being poured manually through a funnel, and it is entering into the delivery pipe, and it enters into the volute casing, and then it enters into the suction pipe. Priming is also required in order to remove the air which is trapped in the pump. When the air is trapped in the pump, and then when you fill the water in the delivery pipe, volute casing, and then the suction pipe manually, all the air which is present in the suction pipe or in the volute casing, it is reduced, and it is removed, and it reduces the risk of pump damage during the startup. The presence of air in the pump creates the small negative pressure at the suction pipe, which prevents the suction of water. That is why whenever we tell the disadvantage as relatively less or low suction power, it is because of the presence of air. You might have observed at your houses that at some times the pump might not be lifting the water to the overhead tank. At that time, it is understood that there is presence of air, and you need to remove the air which is trapped in the pump, and that is done with the help of a process called as priming. And it is nothing but it is actually creating a small negative pressure at the suction pipe, which is preventing the suction of water from the water sump. So this is about priming. So hope you have understood the concept of the centrifugal pump, the concept of cavitation, the concept of priming. So this is all about for in the today's lecture. In the next lecture, we'll be understanding about the reciprocating pump. Thank you all.